With the topic of the new use of femtosecond laser to excise lenticles in the procedure called SMILE and FLEX. First of all, femtosecond lasers are a photodisruptive technology that indeed are capable to cut and excise. They are really very sophisticated and very precise scalpels that works with a wavelength that is non-toxic, totally different to the ultraviolet light of the SMILE laser. And as far as we don't overpass the photodisruption threshold, we have a very atraumatic excision. We can do, based on this capability of precision, an atraumatic profile, intrastromal conical lenticulus photodisruption that can be extracted either with the use of a flap, which is FLEX, or with a very small incision, which is at this moment about 40 degrees, which makes the SMILE procedure to be at this moment working. So we are now in an era of minimally invasive surgery. Minimally invasive surgery means that we need to create a minimal trauma, and looking for this minimal trauma, SMILE lasers have gone for a faster laser ablation with the reduction of collateral thermal tissue damage using smaller amounts of energy and much smaller laser beams. Eye tracking accentuation have made the possibilities of decentration to be really very, very improbable today, and we have a wavefront guided ablation profiles, either wavefront guided on the cornea or the total wavefront, which are indeed improving today special cases. Femtosecond lasers have of course made an important progress as well, as far as they preserve a probably better cornea biomechanics. Let me tell you probably, because this is still under investigation, but it's true that it's less invasiveness for corneal nerves in using this technology, and we have on the contrary out from the business of femtosecond laser the other advantages, because central another of the issues that have about femtosecond have been incorporated in modern the technologies, what makes that both are at this moment competing for the surgical refractive market. SMILE is a very nice name, put in my opinion one of the best in the history of ophthalmic surgery. This is my best, my first case with SMILE in Sofia, and look, we are smiling because this is for the corneal surgeon a very rewarding technique. It's really the art of removing the lenticle. It is not, let me tell you, as boring as LASIK. It is really a technique that attracts the refractive surgeon if you are a corneal surgeon as well. Let me show to you my first SMILE. This will show to you the hesitations or not that you have when doing this SMILE procedure. SMILE has to be performed after performing 25 to 40 FLEX, that means with flap, lenticular extractions, and here with an adequate spatula, which is really the normal one, you dissect first the front part, then the second and the posterior part, and then you can with adequate forceps to extract the lenticle, which usually is extracted very easily. And what admires me from the beginning was the precision to eliminate this lenticle in the whole around the surface without losing tissue, without having major difficulties in the excision, with the precision that you will see later on. And indeed this has been made a progress in the last 5 years tremendously, from theory to the practice. This is the lenticle. Lenticle is very strong. You have to think that cornea means in Greek heart. It's a heart tissue, and we always verify that we have extracted the whole lenticle without leaving any part of tissue, and usually in 99% of the cases you leave nothing. So this is really feasible, and for the normal corneal refractive surgeon is really a technique that is very rewarding, as I mentioned to you. What I'm showing to you is our initial experience comparing a FLEX SMILE and LASIK. We have been using LASIK for 25 years. And we had matched groups for age and refraction, for FLEX, for SMILE, and for LASIK. As you see, we have exactly the same cases with SMILE and FLEX than the ones that we had for LASIK. LASIK was performed with a sixth-generation SMILE laser, and we did a prospective comparative matched groups of patients, and we were evaluating the efficacy, safety, predictability, and also the biomechanical analysis by a mathematical model that we showed to you. In safety, we could not detect any particular difference, significant, between SMILE, FLEX, and LASIK. Same was with the efficacy, both were the three techniques were the same, and we accumulated SMILE and FLEX were identical to LASIK, and same happened with the predictability. So basically we were doing both in plus minus 0.5 and plus 1 diopter around emmetropia about the same job. We developed, and this has been published in 2008, a mathematical model in which we were deducting the biomechanical properties of the cornea, comparing the target radius of curvature of the profile of the excision with the real obtained one as measured by the corneal topography. This has been published, and indeed, if you get immediately after the photodisruption or the examiner laser ablation the same radius of curvature that you have obtained, that means that you have matched the target. If you get less, it's because you have undertreated and you have a problem in the technique. But if you get the same at the beginning and later on it changes, it should be because changes in the corneal biomechanics. So this is how you can indirectly measure corneal biomechanics with this model. This is the way in which it is compared, and we have a coefficient, which is the coefficient of biomechanical response. That is the one that we compare in the among the three techniques. Indeed, we have the tensile power that is less affected in PRK, more effective in LASIK, and should be minimally affected in SMILE, because as you know, we preserve 135 microns of the superficial cornea, which is where the keratocytes are and where most of the strength of the cornea is located. Let me remind to you that the keratoconus start because of the disruption in the Bowman membrane, that means in the initial surface of the cornea. So the target versus obtained radius of curvature measured over time demonstrated that we had for a SMILE group slightly better profile. So even that the differences were at the limit of statistical significance, we are now making a much more extensive study about this. The trend was that the SMILE is really confirming that to make a flap makes a difference in terms of creating a biomechanical negative response. So the cornea should be left more consistent and more stable following a SMILE than following flex and LASIK. And obviously, LASIK and flex should be identical because both have a flap and both are accessing a certain amount of tissue. So if we have to compare SMILE versus LASIK, and I'm talking about the latest generation of examiner lasers we have, and this is my personal evidence and my personal appreciation at this moment, we're dealing with similar efficacy, safety, and predictability. So no advantage one over the other, which is really outstanding because we are dealing with examiner lasers with 25 years history, and with SMILE and flex, we have almost not yet 5 years of history. So definitely this technique is in the early beginning, but it's very promising because at least we get in myopia and astigmatism the same outcomes that we have with examiner laser. SMILE is not a difficult technique if you are a corneal refractive surgeon, that most of the surgeons in Europe and in this area are dealing with cornea and refractive, so you are trained for cornea. You are not only an examiner laser surgeon, and this is a technique that has a fast learning curve. You can take your first 25 cases with SMILE just to know how to dissect the posterior and the anterior part of the lenticle, and later on SMILE is really a very nice and very rewarding technique surgically wise. And I perceive a clear future for SMILE, because if you think that we can have with one laser the capability to treat all refractive errors, including hyperopia, which is still under development, definitely you have one machine less, which is examiner laser, one device that is helping you for corneal graft, for tunnels, and for other purposes as well. And indeed, you have indeed one issue that high myopia is going to be again in the hands of the corneal refractive surgeon, not with FKKUs, because we're going down to minus 12 or more diopters for excision, because as far as this biomechanical condition, it seems to be better preserve, we are going back to the cornea for high refractions. And indeed, it's true that we are investigating, indeed, there is no clear evidence, but the trend is there, that we are leaving a better ocular surface with less problems as far as corneal reinnervation is not as much. As far as we preserve the main corneal trunks, we preserve better biomechanical stability. And what is true is that long-term stability is absolutely outstanding. In the cases of other surgeries, such as Dan Reinstein, it's obvious that the long-term stability for high corrections is better than with LASIK, but this study is not yet finished. So as a conclusion, I can tell you that this is ongoing. In my opinion, the future will be for femtosecond laser, even though we have a long way still to go. Thank you very much. Thank you.
I have a question for you, Dr. Ali. What about the visual recovery after SMILE? We all know that after femtosecond laser, after a few hours, the patient can see 20 over 20. What about the visual recovery in SMILE?
The Thank you. The visual recovery is slightly slower. So usually you have the next day in about 80% of the cases, almost full vision in the LASIK group. You have about 60% in the SMILE group. It's true that you have a slight delay on that. It's true that this is related to the amount of excision. So the more the range that you are dealing with, the more slowly is the recovery. And most of the patients are in 5 days about the maximum vision that it should get. So you have to think that there is a gap of about 4 or 5 days between LASIK and SMILE to recover full vision in some specific cases, and this is especially at the very beginning in cases that it takes longer for you to eliminate to dissect the lenticle. It might take a little bit longer, but it's not as much as it was thought. In my hands has not been like this. Let me tell you that the visual recovery has been outstandingly good, even that I have tonnage that is slightly more slowly going, but it's not a big deal, and the difference is worldwide. Now you are doing at the same time, and you go up to 4 diopters of astigmatism. In data that is not here, yes, because these cases we deal with astigmatism up to 2 diopters. So we were a little bit more conservative because we wanted to be sure that we were moving ahead properly. Now up to 4 diopters, we don't find major differences. And talking about clinical differences, still the data is not fully analyzed. Stability is outstandingly good. So from the very beginning, you might have a slight delay in the recovery of vision, which is not a great deal, let me tell you. But the stability is from the very beginning, they're saying you don't see the refraction to move at all. In this minus 10, for instance, or minus 12 that you do, the restriction now is to minus 10. And there is a particular protocol to go to minus 12 that is under investigation now, that if you go to the limits of minus 10, which are the ones allowed clinically, definitely you don't see changes over time.
If you allow me, yes, I think a SMILE will be something good in the future, especially after solving the problems of astigmatism and hyperopia, especially. And in the last American Academy, there were a couple of talks about the SMILE, even in post-graft, and they have good results. But the issue now is very small, the mild myopia and the enhancement case. Did you have any cases which needed enhancement and you had to do this enhancement with a very small, thin flap of cornea? I think it would be.
Yeah, you know, this is a very, very important answer. We think that the smaller the refraction, the thinner the lenticle, and this is not true because you work with radius of curvature. You can have a thick layer with an adequate radius of curvature for low myopia or more curve for more myopia. So basically, the lenticle is not a big, it's not a major difference. You can detect differences clinically talking between a minus one, minus 2, a minus 10, but the minus 1 is a consistent, good lenticle, doesn't depend on thickness, depends on radius of curvature.
Mr. Ali, another question, please. Because you are making the section on the cornea, not on the limbus, so the optical zone is smaller than the usual femtosecond LASIK. So what do you think about this regarding the night vision, everything that...
Sorry, good question. The optical is only 6 millimeters, right? And it was one of my concerns, what happens with large pupils? We don't deal now with large pupils as a problem, as we don't do in modern examiner laser surgery. You know that pupil size is no longer a predictor of problems and symptoms, and it's the same with this procedure. Centration is performed initially by the fixation of the patient. So we don't have a tracker, and on the contrary, we have the lenticle perfectly working on the visual axis, because the visual axis is the one that is targeted by the patient, and you fix the eye at that moment. So neither thickness in low myopia, and we do from minus one SMILE. Neither the fixation is different. Fixation is even better. Papers published recently have demonstrated that fixation, even with the most sophisticated eye trackers, is not different or is even better with this man. And finally, the optical profile that you get at 6 millimeter is good. You have no induction of spheric aberration. Major issue. This is a major issue. Indeed, this is reflecting the preservation of the surface of the cornea and the 135 microns, because you have most of the resistance there. So what happens in the under-ablated peripheral area, or in the biomechanical response that makes the peripheral corneal collagen fibers to retract, causing the positive spheric aberration after LASIK, is not happening here. This is one of the major issues, in my opinion, on this technology: the lack of induction of spheric aberration and the adequate performance of a 6 millimeter lenticle instead of what initially was thought. So we have, and you will have, no problems in night vision and no problems related to inadequate sizing of the lenticle. Thank
yes.
you.
Excuse me. And also we have the possibility of increase the thickness of the lenticule without any refractive consequence. So in low grade of myopy, we can increase the lenticule. Also, yes, also talking about the spherical aberration, also the optical zone is, of course, as you said, the edge of the lenticule is not a cut like the excimer, it's a lens. So we are going to above the spherical aberration because of that. And also, I think that the cut with the laser of the lenticule is with the eye absolutely immobilized because of the vacuum. It gives us more safety for doing instead of the excimer that is not well correcting centered. I think that that's all those things are the straight, but I think that we have to improve probably an eye tracker for the astigmatism. This is a step back because of that. Yes, absolutely. And we have also the depth of the hyperopic treatment, but I think, as Dr. Alio, this is the future for sure.
Yeah, but you know, we haven't seen any major difference because cyclotorsion obviously is not existing, there is no eye tracking. But the correction of astigmatism in terms of power and axis have been excellent, always. And at this moment, in over 200 cases, we have one retreatment. And one retreatment was done with PRK. Let me tell you that we don't perform re-smile in these cases. Usually you deal with very small refraction, and the retreatment rate is smaller in my hands than with laser. What reflects really the predictability. Okay, thank you.
So we'll go to the next presentation with Dr. Joaquin Fernandez. We'll talk about bioptics, phakic IOLs after intracorneal ring segment in keratoconus.
Okay, we know for a long time the consequence in clinical and things of keratoconus, probably not as well in the etiology of the disease, but we know the consequence in the refractive, why this is the reason we are losing vision in our patient. For that, I think in the treatment, we have to focus in one hand on the biomechanical situation of the disease, and in the other hand, the consequence of the losing of vision of our patient. We have two causes. Probably one of them is the coma aberration. If we have a peripheral ectasia or a spherical aberration, is less frequently with a very central keratoconus, and also the increase of the defocus, but overall the astigmatism or our patient. And we have to ask how to treat correctly our patient. We have a lot of skill for treat our patient. Even contact lens can do a lot of for them, but we know that the contact lens could increase the problem with a superficial allergic situation. So we have that skill, the interstomal corner semi-ring, that allow the reduction of the astigmatism and other pronounced aberration, as we told, the spherical aberration in a very center patient. And we follow the nomogram for intracorneal semi-ring created in Spain with a very large experience. More or less, I think that the final idea is what is the axis of the astigmatism and where is the axis of the coma in this patient. I think that we have to center the treatment in treat the coma aberration, because this is the perfect skill if we have a very high amount of coma aberration in order to correct and in order to improve the quality of vision we have, because we only have that that possibility on also the rigid contact lens. I think that in the future we are going to have the lack of contained with the next nomogram of the group of Dr. Alio, because it's based on a neuronal red net that the own nomogram is learning about the consequence of the treatment, and probably it's going to be a very promised situation. So in keratoconus, first of all, we think about the evolution of the biomechanical, thinking about doing or not cross-linking, but we are centering and focusing in the treatment of the coma. After that, after probably 6 months, we have a very stabilized keratoconus. We think about the strategy of the intracorneal submarine and think about the focus of the coma treatment. After that, we think in the refractive evolution of the patient, and we think about the possibility of implant an ICL toric lens. So, as we told, we first of all, we like to decrease the coma aberration, and after, think about the astigmatism and also the MAP. We have a lot of evidence talking about the possibility of the reduction, not only the coma aberration, but also the refractive. But I think it's very interesting to think about that slide. With the additive effect of the intracorneal submarine, we could treat around 7 diopters at maximum of astigmatism regulation, depending, of course, of the corneal thickness, with cross-linking no more than 2 diopters, but the precision and the amount of the correction of the defocus and also the astigmatism is so much better with the phakic eye oil that the other treatment. So in the clinical case that I would like to show you, we have a female of 27 years old with keratoconus. The visual acuity is 0.4. I think it's very interesting focusing in that situation. And with that amount of astigmatism, we have here the same abscess of the coma and the aberration. You have here the amount of the coma aberration is a very high level. And we reduce in the first procedure the astigmatism, but also the coma, because if the same axis in that situation, and also, as you see, the amount of aberration, and we can see the difference in the preoperatory and the postoperatory reduction, and also the coma aberration. And now we can implant the ICL in order to correct the visual acuity reduction, the defocus, the residual defocus, and also the astigmatism. One very interesting idea is probably in the next future we are going to have to change the nomogram with the ICL, because in cases of keratoconus we need a specific nomogram for ICL for keratoconus, because of the ICD. The ICD quantity is very important to calculate not also the refraction of the lens, but also the sizing of the lens. In terms of calculate the refraction of the lens, we need the actual ICD of the keratoconus, but in terms of calculate the sizing, is not exactly the real of now ICD. So probably we have to change, have a nomogram base like a double K with we do in the postoperatory refractive surgery. We need in keratoconus a double ACD to calculate in keratoconus patient. It's very easy, as you can see, and after the surgery we could achieve that amount of refractive of the focus and astigmatism, probably multiply for a zero for two. We achieve in the end visual acuity of 0.8 vision, And well, in conclusion, I think that the interstomal corneal submarine in keratoconus allow to reduce not only the corneal aberration, such coma and astigmatism, and in the selection of corneal rim, preferred correction the cornea instead of the astigmatism. So the toric ICL is a secure, efficient option in order to reduce residual refractive errors after the intracorneal submarine. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Fernandez, for the nice presentation. Next presentation, Dr. Tamer Gamali, who will talk about femtosecond astigmatic keratotomy.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. A very interesting topic today I'm going to talk about is the femtosecond astigmatic keratotomy, because usually sometimes we are facing some patients with having a high degree of astigmatism affecting their vision, and the regular laser and non-laser options for correcting their visual acuity are not optimal in some cases. So here is a patient of mine who came to do a corneal graft for a central corneal scar, a herpetic central corneal scar, and this was done and the patient was followed up regularly with the proper medication for the first few months, and then I started to remove the sutures selectively after the fifth month till the almost a year, 12 months, and his vision was interestingly 20/30 with plus one and half and minus two. And then he had four more sutures in his cornea, and I thought, I was afraid because he was traveling back home and for 2-3 months, I was afraid of having any possibility of rejection while he's not around. So I thought I'll remove the rest of the sutures. But this is what happened. This was the last visit after a week of removing the suture. And then the patient, before leaving, he came and I saw this astigmatism starting to increase in the left eye where the cornea were done. And then increased more, plus one and minus 5.25, and reaching plus 1.75 and minus 9 degrees of astigmatism in the graft that I removed the sutures for. So I had to think about an option for him to give him a good vision to, because he had this good vision. This is his tomography after removing all sutures, and you can see here that the central bathymetry was about 573 microns. So what can we do for this patient? Can I do him laser refractive surgery, surface ablation? I don't think so, because of the healing issues and the herpetic problems he had before. Very high astigmatism for doing LASIK even with the cross-cylinder technique. So can we do him fake IOL? Does it worth? He's 50-something. And or clear lens extraction, this again, very high astigmatism. So I started to think about doing astigmatic keratotomy. And this astigmatic keratotomy were done before with the diamond knife, with an old nomogram. The larger the smaller the zone you are working in, and the extension is more in the corneal thickness, and the increasing the angular length will make the effect more and more. So I tried to do this with the femtosecond laser, because we have the intralase machine, and we tried to do this. And one of the applications of the femtosecond is to do arcuate incision. So I looked at the patient and I told him I might have a solution for you, and then I put the data of the patient, and we put the nomogram for it to do the femtosecond astigmatic keratotomy. And you can see here that we reach a depth of 440. I've done a little bit of adjustment of the cuts to be coordinating with the astigmatism, the Steve axis of the cornea, according to the topography done for the patient preoperatively. And you can see here that the operation is very simple, takes about few seconds. This is the edge of the keratoplasty, and this is the cuts that we intended to do, and it was very, it takes about 8 seconds. And then under the microscope, I just want to be sure that the lamellae is good, no extension of the lamellae in between these cuts. And then the patient was surprised, you can go home, take medication. He said, did we finish? I told him yes. After about 1 month, he reached -3, -1. So a drop of the astigmatism from 9 to 1. Of course, he gained a few myopic because of the counteraction of the astigmatism. And then you can see here the topography of the patient preoperatively and postoperatively. A little bit of more regularization in the central area of the cornea enabled the patient to see more. This is a Bentacam image where you can see here the edges of the keratoplasty with the cuts of the astigmatic keratotomy. And this is an anterior segment osseity showing the astigmatic keratotomy again. So this patient was very satisfied because he had a monovision. He can see now with the left eye the near things, and with the right eye the far objects. So he said, I'm very satisfied like this. I don't want any further intervention, and I'm happy with this result. So we've done a little bit of work on this with the group in Maghrabi, in Saudi Arabia, Dr. Alaa, Ayman Nasser, Taraf Samia, and Hamid Anwar. And they've done a lot of cases, actually, because they have a lot of high number of cases there in Saudi Arabia. And you can see here that many of the cases benefited from the femtosecond astigmatic keratotomy. A little bit of refinement of the nomogram, as well as the adjustment of the astigmatic cuts on the topography according to the patient. This is the preoperative measurements of the patient, +3, -7, and this is the postoperative results. Amazing. 7 degrees of astigmatism reducing the same after a simple procedure. What about this patient? Again, a very good results, reducing about 6 diopters of astigmatism. And this is the cuts of the astigmatic keratotomy again on the cornea. In some cases, it needed more adjustment. But in these cases, as you can see here, patient with a compound myopic astigmatism can see that the results are not that much as the mixed astigmatism cases, and a little bit improvement. But this is again give us a little bit of more options for the patients to let him see better with the new glasses given to him, or even to make him a new correction. Method of correction of his refractive error. This is a case, again, reduced about 5 diopters astigmatism. The patient can see 20/25 in both cases. So I think that this technique is a very important technique, and we can depend on it in many cases of keratoplasty, postoperative astigmatism, keratoplasty, to reduce the high numbers of astigmatism. What we are going to do to, as I said, adjust a little bit the nomogram according to the amount of error more and more, and to make it a little bit corneal adjusted according to the topography of the patient, and to make these, if you found any fresh cases without even topography, post keratoplasty, I think it will be something which will be having a very good results in a very short time. So I think that femtosecond astigmatic keratotomy is a very good option for correcting astigmatism in many cases, and further refinement and adjustment of the nomogram will help us in treating more and more patients, and that the femtosecond laser is a very good additive tool in the ophthalmology department, not only in the laser refractive surgery, but in corneal surgeries as well. And the current applications are very good, and the first advancement in the femtosecond will be remarkable. Thank you.
Thank you, Taber, for your interesting presentation. I have a few questions for you. Okay, Dr. Shah.
Question. So what do you think about this?
Well, actually, I followed up this patient for more than 3 years, and he has this stable refraction. Of course, I left Oman, you know, 2012, so I stopped following up him. But till I left, 3 years of follow-up, the same refraction every 6 months. I'm making the patient visiting me in my clinic, and I'm proud of what I did to him. In this particular case, I used the 6 millimeter zone to do it inside the graft to give the best effect to the patient.
Okay, well, congratulations. Very interesting presentation, very remarkable outcomes. And I have been surprised by the OCT because usually those like us that have performed RK and asthmatic keratotomy many years ago, we know that we should be very deep to be effective, or otherwise partial result is obtained. But you saw that you are about 70% of the total thickness, at least in the image that you saw, and the result was very good. So which are the reasons? Is there a small optical zone? Is this something that you see in repetition that is happening? How deep do you try to go? This question is what I want to...
Well, actually, as I mentioned, that it was about 75% of the thickness. We thought, as you thought, that the deeper the issue, it might be increasing the effect more. But because it was the first cases, so we didn't want to go more deep to see the results first. And as I said also, we are trying to do some adjustment in the nomogram for according to the ASTE astigmatism, so that can we know if we can go deeper with this astigmatism, can it make more effect or not? But of course, the cases that comes mainly are post keratoplasty cases with this mixed astigmatism. To it's not that much common to have them because of the guarded selective removal suture we're trying to do to let the patient free of glasses. But at the end, whenever there is a case, we are adjusting a little bit the depth and the diameter of the treatment.
Yes, as far as I know, there is no nomogram for this because all the nomograms that don't fail, etc., are for asthmatic keratotomy, but for cataract surgery. So which is the nomogram that you follow?
It's the same one, the same one, the old one, but we're trying to do a little bit of refinement.
All of the audience can ask, can we do regular astigmatism?
And?
This procedure can be done in irregular astigmatism? Irregular astigmatism.
Irregular astigmatism. Of course, if there is a case, I think we it can manage in these cases. But what we noticed that, as I said, in compound myopic astigmatism, the results are not that much as in irregular cases.
Okay, I have noticed here that you are open the incision.
Yes.
You are doing this in all cases, or this is this case only because it's high astigmatism?
In every case, we are trying to separate the lamellae so that we are sure that we are in the correct depth the whole through the incision, as well as sometimes the lamellae, if there are strands of lamellae, it might decrease the effect
because
a little bit.
The other opinion that to avoid overcorrection, it's better to see the results after the post-operative.
Well, actually, you are doing it in the operation room, so no worries about infection, because in all times,
I'm talking about the overcorrection. I'm not talking about the infection.
The overcorrection. We didn't have overcorrection till now. We need to correct things more. So I don't think this is an issue with just guarded nomogram a little bit. We are trying to be as soft as possible to the patient so that we don't have this overcorrection.
And for the corneal thickness, you are depending on pentacam, ultrasound, bathymetry, or what?
Actually, I'm doing preoperatively in the clinic and the pentacam, and intraoperatively with the sonogauge. Because the sonogauge is a very accurate machine to measure it even intraoperatively, and then we calculate intraoperatively the depth that we're going to cut through.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr.
Thank you.
So our next presentation will be one of the most controversy in the subject in the cornea. Can we use topical steroid in infectious keratitis or no? Can we put the question, please? Okay, should topical steroids be used within the first few days before treating known bacterial keratitis? Dr. Hisham?
Uh, Good morning again. This is another controversy. Should we use topical steroid in a known bacterial or documented corneal bacterial ulcer? So the answer will be in the SCAT study, which is steroid in corneal ulcer trial. It is a prospective, masked, randomized, multi-center clinical trial. It involves about 500 patients with culture-positive ulcer in USA and India. And they started 48 hours of topical antibiotics, then randomized to topical prednisolone phosphate 1% eye drops every walking hour for the first 48 hours, then every 2 hours still epithelialization, and then twice daily for a week, then once daily for another week. And the final result that there is no overall difference in 3 months best corrected visual acuity and no safety concern with adjunctive steroid therapy for bacterial ulcers. But when I go through the study in details and I saw the other parameters, so we found other things and other data that will help in doing the which is better, steroid to use or not. So when I go through the study, more severe ulcer did better with topical steroid. Like counting finger vision or worse, has better vision with the steroid and is significantly, statistically significant. And the complete central ulcer as baseline had a better vision with the steroid, with a B value 0.02. In the SCAT study also, when we go to other parameters, we found that nocardia bacteria, it is 11% in the study, and it manifests by better presenting visual acuity, less improvement in the acuity, and it is the worst response to steroid. So this is the worst response to steroid, so never use steroid in nocardia organism. And after 12-month data, if nocardia was excluded, steroid will be associated with a mean one-line improvement in best corrected visual acuity, which is significant. So should we use steroid early? Also in a SCAT study, this question answered. So the timing of topical steroid, steroid started with 2 or 3 days of antibiotic versus after 3 days of antibiotic. And the early steroid therapy associated with one line better vision at 3 months with a P value of 0.01. Again, what is the risk factors that mentioned in this study? So the risk are nocardia, fungi, acanthamoeba. So this is the risk factor that you shouldn't use any steroid. And local epidemiological key, different from country to country. Cultures are necessary and encouraged before starting this steroid. And this was seen in my first talk. Attention to clinical features and the clinical process. This is very important. You should, whenever you start a steroid, you should have a very close up follow-up for the patient to see if there is any change in the clinical course or clinical features or any adding infection or organism. So we should consider a steroid early based on the SCAT study. Consider if ulcers are bacterial with low probability of nocardia, fungi, or acanthamoeba. You should have a culture data. Central or more severe ulcer you should use. Avoid any atypical or indolent cases. Again, you should have an attention to steroid adverse effects because we all know that it makes a delayed epithelialization, increasing the intraocular pressure much more frequently than in a normal eye. There is some special consideration that we should look for it. Not all the bacteria are the same. As we see in this slides, in both eyes, you have interstitial crystalline keratopathy, which is very resistant and it comes with steroid therapy, so you should be careful about this issue. Another one, all that glitter is not gold, because we have a very severe Pseudomonas infection that you cannot use a steroid in such cases. Another one, a patient came to you, okay, I stopped the steroid, so after stopping the steroid, you have this, and it proved to be a fungal keratitis on both photos. Another patient, I feel so much better when I use the steroid, doctor. So it proved this one to be an acanthamoeba, because the steroid will decrease the pain that the patient have. So just no steroid if you have any traumatic ulcer, because you have high probability of fungal keratitis. Contact lens ulcer in tropical region especially, or if the patient has poor contact lens hygiene, so for the possibility of acanthamoeba and fungus. And if you have a better improvement of the ulcer, and then you have decrease or worsening ulcer after initial improving, so no steroid also. So my take-home message is, if you have culture-proven bacterial keratitis, excluding nocardia, with vision threatening, use steroid cautiously with a very, very close follow-up to monitor any clinical response features or change, and to detect any steroid complication. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Hisham. Can we put the question again and start voting for the question?
Still the same. Okay.
So all agree to use steroid. Okay. No, don't use steroid. Don't use steroid.
To be started in a special situation, because it decreases the scarring and minimize the inflammation, but in certain cases, not all the cases. Thank you.
Now we'll go to another subject, which is corneal enlase. Dr. Antonio Marino will talk about selection of patients for camera corneal enlase.
Good morning. Now we change to another subject, corneal enlase, and I will present the selection of patients for camera inlay. So camera inlay, you all know, it's a small aperture corneal inlay, only 3.8 millimeters in diameter, with a central opening of 1.6 millimeters and only 5 micro thick. The mechanism of action, it increases the depth of focus, improving the near vision, minimally disturbing the far vision. The camera inlay, like all corneal inlays for presbyopia, is implanted in non-dominant eye and is implanted at a depth at least minimum 200 microns with a pocket, preferably, or beneath a flap. What about selection of patients? Who are the target patients for this surgery? Of course, presbyopes. The age range normally goes from 47 early presbyopia to 55 years of age, although we can increase up to 60 years. The first important point for this surgery, like all kinds of refractive surgery, is motivation. The patient should be motivated not to wear near glasses, but I think with our results that Dr. Alio will show later, the patient should be not very demanding for near work. A patient who has to have continuous near work, like computer work, like reading several hours, is probably not a good candidate for this surgery. And these patients should accept to wear reading glasses for more important near tasks. Of course, in the pre-op evaluation, we must have a healthy eye, of course, for refractive surgery, and it's very important to do the topography of the cornea and also the aberrometry of the cornea and the eye. Concerning the topography, first of all, we have to exclude any ectactic disorders, and even subclinical keratoconus or semiectactic disorders. These patients are not, of course, eligible for this surgery. Another issue is the corneal thickness. We need at least 500 micra to implant the camera inlay. And another very important point in topography that is sometimes overlooked is the kappa distance. The kappa distance is defined as the distance between the center of the pupil and the line of vision, that's the first Purkinje image. We can do with the AcuTarget, that is a device provided by the company AcuFocus that sells the inlay, but you can do that in other topographies, like in my case, I do also in the Galilei topography. This kappa distance is important because it will conditionate the centration of the implant. If the center of the pupil and the first Purkinje image are almost coincidental, the case is better, we can centrate the implant there. If the kappa distance is large, we must centrate the implant halfway between both images. And you know, this is very nice talking here theoretically, but once you are in the microscope, it's not so easy to do the centration. So better cases if the kappa distance is small. Another important point is aberrometry. Aberrometry evaluation is very important because if you have high order aberrations like the coma, trefoil or quadrefoil, I think these patients are not suitable for this kind of surgery. Another very important point and sometimes overlooked point, because we say, of course, the camera inlay is implanted in the non-dominant eye, but which is the dominant eye? How we test eye dominance? It's not so easy to do that. Eye dominance can be tested in both ways, a motor test and a sensorial test. In the motor test, the patient looks through a hole to a target with both eyes open. Then, when the dominant eye is occluded, the image will be outside of the hole. In the sensorial test, the patients look to a target with both eyes, wearing the far correction, and we add alternately a positive sphere, 1.5, to each eye. When the patient says that the image is more blurred, that the minus 1.5 is on the dominant eye. But sometimes, this is also very nice said here, but in clinical practice, sometimes, okay, everything is okay. Motor and sensorial tests agree. This, of course, shows a strong dominance. This is a good case. We know exactly in which eye we are going to implant the camera. But many times, the tests disagree. Where are we going to implant the camera? We don't know. It shows a weak dominance. In my cases, I use the sensorial test. But of course, here we can have some doubts. And you can repeat the test 2, 3, 4 times, and the results keep changing. So the surgery we have seen is implanted in a non-dominant eye, in a pocket if the refraction is plano or slightly myopic, or with a flap, or with a flap plus pocket, 2 steps if the refraction is another one. This is a typical case of implantation. You see the implant has 2 sides, 1 dull side and 1 shining side. The dull side should be up. So, what about another important point? Which refraction of the patients is better to implant the camera? We can have myopes, emmetropes, and hyperopes. In my experience, compared to other publications, I prefer the low myopes. I get the best results in my cases in low myopes, where I do the pocket if the myopia is okay, or I do the flap if the myopia is higher than minus 1, and I correct the myopia totally in one eye, leave some myopia in the eye with the camera, and in these cases, in most of the cases, we have a happy patient. This is not the case of the emmetropes. Emmetropes, every time you have to do a flap, or a flap plus a pocket, because if you implant in the emmetropic eye, plain emmetropic eye, only the pocket, the results will be normally poor. We need really the low-grade myopia we have to create in these cases. Motivation here is very important, but most of these emmetropes implanted, they will use glasses for continued work. And the hyperopes, what about the hyperopes? The hyperopes are normally those who, in many publications, will be the best cases. They gave good results, but I am not keen in doing this implantation in hyperopes for two reasons. First, because hyperope in this age range may increase with time, and if it increases with time, the results will go away. And another reason, with hyperopes, I have very, very good results with refractive lens exchange. The patients are very happy, so I'm not doing now hyperopes with this technique, although you can do it. So in conclusion, implantation of Camurent Ley is fast and reversible, although the reversibility could be discussed later, improves near vision in presbyopes without, and this is a reality, minimally disturbing the far vision. Concerning the selection of patients, that is my topic. Our guidelines are motivation in the first place. It's very important not to promise everything to these patients. We have to have a normal topography and aberrometry. If we can have a strong eye dominance, it will be a good case. And I think the low myopes combined with LASIK will be the best case. Thank you very much.
Thank you for a nice presentation. Thank you very much. So the next presentation, Dr. Ali will talk about the intracorneal inlay and is the solution for presbyopia in cornea.
Thank you very much. And this presentation is to complete part of what Dr. Marino has mentioned and indeed tries to clarify our position in this technology that indeed we use for the correction of presbyopia, but under certain conditions as I will mention to you immediately. We have been working with intracorneal inlays for almost 10 years already. We have been working first with the permalens inlay for the correction of hyperopia. Then we enter into the study. We don't have slides. I can talk with our slides anyway, right? Yeah. Then we went into the correction of presbyopia with the Candra, with the different hydrogels. And so what I'm going to show to you is the summary of our experience. So our topic is this question: is this a solution of the cornea? Is the solution of the presbyopia at the cornea or not? We know that corneal accommodation, what we can call like this, can be based on two different techniques. One is multifocality, and the second, an increased depth of field. And this works for presby LASIK procedures, and also works for this type of intracorneal inlays procedures. Okay, so indeed, to implant and a synthetic layer inside the cornea has an attractive profile. And it's an attractive profile because of several reasons. First, because it might be reversible. Even that surgery is not reversible, indeed it's true that you can take out this device and then to leave the cornea approximately like it was before. Second, you have to leave it permanent if you want. So it could be a solution even if the patient has later cataract surgery and you remove the crystalline lens when it is opaque. It can be adjusted, and some of the techniques, for instance, the hydrogels, the presby lens, you have +2 or +3, you can change with time if you want to a higher power in case that you find it convenient. Indeed, this is minimally invasive surgery, but it's true. It should be predictable, and it's true that it's to some extent predictable. It's true that you have a simple training because most of the time you use a quite a sophisticated device, which is easy to use with the femtosecond, but don't misunderstand, this is a simple technique. It's not, needs to be training, and you will see some difficulties with this training when you are going to use it. It's tricky, let's say. The optical power, in case that you use the hydrogels, can be done on request. And the cornea, indeed, is an accessible tissue that is available at this moment in terms of surgical solutions that are existing for a long time already. So this is the why we have a long history. This is not new. Many people were attracted by this idea a long time ago. And the first was José Ignacio Barraquer in Colombia, which started in 49 with flint glass, then Choice used polysulfones, and McCurry and Andrews started using the hydrogel. So this is an old idea with a long way of trial and error. Many people have tried, many people have failed. And why it has not been yet successful? Because we cannot say today that this technique is successful. First, because cone anatomy and histology, the cone metabolism,
The biotolerance optical performance plays a role and is not as simple as it looks. And definitely this transparent tissue, which is the cornea, is not a simplified tissue, is not a simplified model, takes time to understand the reaction. And indeed, this is the reason why we have been learning for many years about how to use this technology. If you go to the literature up to December 2014, you have 30 papers in peer-reviewed journals. The number of experimental studies have been 4, clinical reports are 19, biomaterials are 5, and the scientific level of evidence at this moment is 2/3, which is good. So that means that in the literature, we have good a level of evidence to know what is happening, and so let's go to know what is happening today. We have refractive and we have pinhole implants. The refractive are based on the use of hydrogels, and the pinhole has been already mentioned by Dr. Marinho, so I'm going to not to repeat what he has been doing. Refractive hydrogels are the most common biomaterial, indeed, has been a subject of the studies about biotolerance and many others have been, which has been published so far, and all of them have the same material and they have slightly differences, but different techniques, but basically they are all the same. They are following the same idea because the patents are broken already because more than 20 years of them have been eliminated, this protection, and so they are copying one after the other. So they are about the same. You have to think that to implant an inlay in the cornea has more effect than to make a correction in the lens. The optical power of the cornea and the cornea itself is a very robust tissue, and what you add in the cornea as 2 diopters is like having in the intraocular a +4. So if you want to have a +4 restored, and it's out from the market now, you need to implant a +3. If you want to have a +3, then you need a +2. It's about that. So you need low powers to deal with the cornea in comparison with what you use in intraocular lenses. And this is a paper that we published about the hyperopia, the use of inlays in hyperopia and complications, and we could, and this is reported in ophthalmology, that after 5 years, the rate of explantations were about 40% related to different reasons. Number one was a biotolerance and development of haze, and the second was the induction of poor quality of vision due to the presence of hagger or the aberrations in relevant matters. The tolerance is indeed an issue. This material is tolerated, but interferes with the metabolism of the cornea. This is the reason why you have haze and you have epithelial cells. At the beginning we thought they were epithelial cells, but they are not. They look epithelial, but they are epithelial cells. That means that they are macrophages which has suffered a transformation as a foreign body cell. So this is a foreign body reaction that happens around the hydrogels, and this is why this haziness that appears in some of the cases, especially if they are implanted in the middle of the stroma. We have also that the optical performance was analyzed and published by us in another paper, also in ophthalmology. And we could have that the problem of centration was really important because the offset from the visual axis makes these implants to be the subject of the induction of high levels of coma in cases of hyperopia correction. This happened as well with the hydrogels used for presbyopia. The centration is poor or is inadequate or is impossible to be sure that you are centered in the center of the cornea. And this is the reason why you should expect to increase coma aberration and to lose some lines of excavated vision depending on how far away you are from the center. The scientific evidence coming from the published literature is that this should be deep in the corneal tissue. So it's not new that they claim to be making a deep implant. They need to be at least 76% of the depth, which means in a Caucasian normal cornea, 380 microns. We have in Europe about 525 microns as a mean. So this has to be about 400 microns, which seems to be deep, but this is when you have to allocate the implant not to be out from the metabolic problems that I'm going to explain to you. This should be stable. And this should not change for thermical change and dimensional, so this should not be creating a problem in dimension based on the implantation in the cornea in different levels. Some of them can become dehydrated, and this is a problem. The power should be limited because reasons related to the thickness, and the biocompatibility long term is related to this thickness, because then, if not, you are interfering with part of the metabolism. This should be isorefractive of the cornea, so hyper index of refraction doesn't make well with the vision at the the cornea, they should be thin, the pocket should be better than a flap because you interfere less with the optic nerve, with the corneal nerves, and you need to know that the flow of metabolic products, particularly oxygen and the glucose from the endothelium and from the epithelium is affected by the presence of the inlay, is affected at the center of the cornea. That means that you can develop an opacity based on this epithelioid cells reaction that I mentioned to you, and this should be as deep as possible because most of these products are coming from the epithelium and much less from the endothelium as well. This is for the oxygen and this is for the glucose. As you see, both of them are not dealing about the same, and you have to know that this metabolic imbalance is happening if you overpass the 3 millimeters of the cornea, what happens during some of the implants that we are studying today. In the hydrogels group, you have the Flexiview, Presbyopia, the Icolens, which is the raindrop, the raindrop from Revision Optics. They are the same material. This is 2 millimeters. They are 3 millimeters. The thickness is about the same, and all of them are about the same with the problems of centration that I mentioned to you formerly. They work associated to the pupil, and of course you need to study the pupil as we do in presbyopia lasing, because the smaller, with the synergic effect of the vergence and the stimulus to meiosis, you are limiting the entrance of the light through the implant, and so you have the pupil as a limitation for the performance, and those people with poor pupil for performance will not be good candidates for the surgery. Some others, like the presbyopia lens as a whole in the center, to improve this problem with the metabolic imbalance for glucose and oxygen that happens in the inlays, and with this hole, they try to have free from the visual axis this type of opacities that can be seen here, and that happens in many cases after the implantation. The Flexiview will show to you how I implant it. Needs this kind of mask for the intralis, it's the one that I use, the intralis. You make an arc which is about 40 degrees of arc, and then the problems start, because then to grasp these inlays is extremely tricky. They are very slippery, they are very, very thin. You hardly see them under the cornea. This is the implantation device, which in my opinion should be modified to be more precise. It's a little bit bulky, but this is what you have, and then you go into the cornea, and as far as the tunnel is very easy to make, you make a temporal axis, then the implant has to be centered on the center of the pupil, as has been marked here by me, and you see that we are pushing now the implant inside the cornea, and this implant is, at this very moment I selected this one, not doing very well. Due to the very thin profile, this plank is going above or underneath, so the inlay that is hardly seen by you at this moment is folded. Is later on is traction by my getting back the instrument, the injector under the tunnel, as you see, I need to re-inject, and finally is left in position. Is left in position, but not properly centered, and then I need to manipulate to make it in the center of the cornea. This is the inlay profile, this is the center. You need to manipulate using some saline. You have to be careful, because with saline you can get it out very easily, and then you lose the implant, because here it's difficult to recover in case that you lose it. So this is what I call a tricky surgery. What is true is that they make and evidence in the topography, you have an increase in the power of the central cornea, which means that you increase the power. Remember, if you increase the power 2 diopters, it is like a restore plus 3, and then you have a biospheric profile. One is the far periphery or mid far, and then initially, and with this increase in the negative asphericity and increase the center of the power, you have with these lenses about 3 diopters of correction, or let's say 2.5, which is enough for near vision in the implanted eye. The problem is that you gain the lines for near vision, and this is evident, and this is what happens in my series, but at the cost of losing about 2 lines of excoriated vision for far. So this is a monovision that is with no free lines. In monovision, we lose lines of vision for far. Here, you lose lines of vision for far, and this is because of the problems of centration and the problems that the blur is created to these patients that takes some months to adapt, simply because of the problem that they have this interference with the line of sight. It is my experience that it takes longer than with monovision, and this is what is true, is that they can be explanted in the first 6 months uneventfully. What is true as well is that this is the data that has been reported by Palikaris. I'm not with as many cases as him, and I took this information from him. His patients are quite happy, and they perform the task in this monovision condition quite well, and the level of satisfaction of Ioannis Palikaris is good, and I have to tell you that mice are not as happy as this, but this is what I want to tell you. So you have other inlays, which are the ones based in this material, which is the PDVF, which is a kind of Teflon. It's flexible. It has a diameter of 3.8 millimeters. Remember, this is creating a metabolic imbalance in the oxygen and the glucose, so it's expected to have some consequences. And the new model, which is the 5,000, has gone into 8,400 holes. The thickness is much smaller, which is 5 microns, in an attempt to decrease the thickness and to increase the permeability of the implant to metabolic exchange onto the cornea. This is the way in which I'm using the implant. I have been trying many methods, but finally, what I do is, with the light of an endoscope, I allocate the center of the pupil in meiosis, but I mean in meiosis with photo stimuli, not with pilocarpine, because then it's different, and then I elevate the flap. In case that I'm going to ablate, I create the flap, I do ablate, and to leave the refraction, target refraction, about minus 0.75, whatever the refraction of the patient is, and then I am putting the implant, and I'm trying to see, because the mark is here, so you don't see the mark, whether the center of the pupil in this meiotic condition, photoreactive, is indeed there. It's not easy, because you don't see the border of the pupil on the source conditions, and if you are in doubt, then you have to put a drop of saline, and then to move, because it's very sticky to the cornea, so the implant is not unless the hydrogels is not moving out as easily, and then I'm trying to leave it in the place that I want. Okay, the outcomes are clearly in favor that the on-corrected for near visual acuity is improving, and this is true. The far vision is kept for quite a time, and initially you can have a drop in the far vision, which is temporary. The uncorrected intermediate is probably the best achievement of these devices, because they have very good intermediate vision, and indeed they achieve most of the cases adequate vision at that level. This, the uncorrected visual acuity, as you see, has a trend towards be decreased for the first month, and then is reaching the levels of preoperative evolution with a slight decrease that affects only one line in some cases. This is a profile that in the Outfront United States study in which I participated we have. So the mean is that the cases were around 0.8 to 1, with some cases that really decreased, but they were minimal. And so you have a difference with the monovision condition in which these patients will have vision for far of about 2 diopters with a preservation of far vision, so this is not happening as much with monovision and indeed with hydrogels. This is the AcuTarget. This is a device that we use to center. Indeed, indicates to you the deviation from the that you have from the vertex of the cornea and the center of the implant. You have to be around the 300 microns of this corneal vertex, which is the first Purkinje reflex. And indeed, the use of this instrument, in my opinion, is mandatory, because otherwise it's difficult to allocate really the implant in the right place. It's true that you don't have the projection of this image in the microscope. You have to take the patient to the operating room to take back to the instrument to measure, and then if you are not happy with it, you have to take back to the operating room. This is really an inconvenience. I hope that in the future this will be through the operating microscope. Are they explantable? We have been reporting this in this paper published now 1.5 years ago about the removability, and we have been the first to demonstrate that indeed it's true that we can explant, but as far as you do it in the first 6 months. After 6 months of implantation, you leave permanent changes in the cornea and in the barometry profile, which indeed you have to know. Explantability in my hands is happening now in about 20 to 25% of my cases. About biotolerance, we published this confocal microscopy study that was published in last year, and we demonstrated that these findings that we found by confocal time ago were happening as well in the cancer, because this metabolic imbalance is happening. This was one case that was explanted, and months later, look here, this donor shape type of opacity that is located in the area in which the implant was present. This is because of the development of this type of the cellular changes, and is in parallel to the permanence of the implant. Look here, this was Explantable for 6 months. This is a preoperative condition. The condition at the moment of transplantation and 6 months after, as you see, changes are happening, but they are minimal. Let's say the mobility is followed by recovery of almost a normal topography. But if you wait more than 6 months, look what happened. You don't leave this problem alone ever. This patient was a 1 year after, they still showing this applanation with a hyperobsessive, and this donor site of elevation was in parallel with the mild opacity that you see in the middle interface because of this foreign body reaction that we described to you formerly. These are the different aspects that have been reported. Indeed, it's true that you have activated keratocytes all lifelong of the patient. This is what is our experience. You detect epithelial cells. You have some findings that are in parallel what we found time ago, about 10 years ago in our initial reports. So the metabolism of the cornea has not changed. Obviously, it's the same. Problems are the same. You have to be deeper. You have to be smaller. And you need to know that even in these conditions, you will have some metabolic interference. So in conclusion, corneal compensated presbyopia by the use of intracorneal lens can be accomplished with different types. So all of them are working in different ways, but working as well. These methods are feasible, are successful, as far as you follow some rules with some limitations. They may have probably different indications depending on patient profile and corneal anatomy. For instance, you have a patient with a pure pupil. This is not for the hydrogels, but this could be good for the chandra. Chandra is independent from pupil size and pupil performance. And of course, in the intermediate and early presbyope, they may offer a more attractive option that refractive laser exchange, which is indeed traumatic and not indicated, in my opinion, early and intermediate presbyopes. And I thank you for us for your kind attention. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Alio. I have a question. You said the hydrogel lens affecting the distance vision a little bit?
In my experience, yes. And this is because different reasons. One, because you have an increase in the power of the cornea. So obviously, you have a +2, which means a +3 in the center of the line of vision. So these patients should have some neuroadaptation, but this happens in presbylasing. Presbylasing, you have for 1 month less vision for far because of the same reason. But the second is that some of them really have an interference with the light. I cannot tell you why, but it's true that the light scattering is affected, and the patients have noted that. You have to expect from 1 to 3 lines of loss of excavated vision for far, definitely.
So do you recommend the patient to wear a contact lens before the operation to let him to experience the monovision, or it's not necessary for this?
Well, I do what Dr. Marino has mentioned. I study the motor and sensorial dominance, and I go for those patients in which I can detect a dominance. So I really want the far eye to be for far, and then the dominant eye to be for near, because if in a strong dominance, like in monovision, but different, monovision is better if you have intermediate dominance. Here, if you have a strong dominance, it's far better, because then these inconveniences that happen in the operated eye are ignored for the patient most of the time.
Okay, thank you very much.
Decreasing also the corneal sensitivity. So I think the quality of vision, this is something you should depend on for the patient.
Well, it's true that they decrease corneal sensitivity, but they decrease unilaterally. So you have only one eye with this problem, and sensitivity has not been in my hands a problem at all. It's not like in other techniques. Definitely, in my opinion, it's not like a monovision happens in the operated eye, but not in the other eye. So for me, there's no role of sensitivity loss in monovision or in this disease, simply because we mix at the brain level both, and one is normal. And the normal prevails as far as the dominant eye over the other.
Do you recommend this?
I do, but you have to know that you enter into some limitations. It's not a miracle. I am against what means miracle of these devices. They are not, but remember, I told you yesterday, you have 2% cataract disruption in cataract surgery. You have 30% failures in glaucoma surgery, so we have to be ready for failures. But it's true, this fails in about 20% of the cases, about. And if you agree with this and the patient knows that, then you have a chance. It's a chance, in my opinion, it's an alternative to monovision.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
The voting beds at the end of the day. Thank you for your coming.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. I'll introduce Mr. Goydi Naiman from the IFA company, because this is a very interesting and a very new lecture in here in the conference. It will talk about the electronic medical records. It's the topic is health IT in ophthalmology, implementation of an electric medical records in ophthalmology. What are the challenges and results for physicians and patients? Mr. Goyd.
Okay, thank you for the introduction. Welcome to all. So before we start, let me introduce the company a little bit briefly first. So IFA Systems is in the health IT business since more than 30 years. We are a public company listed on the Frankfurt Stock Exchange market, and we are since more than 25 years specialized only in ophthalmology. Every day, more than 13,000 users in 20 different countries are using our system. So the most important components of the health IT are 4 points. So first of all, the electronic medical record for documenting and documenting all your examinations in your daily work. Then the clinical decision support system, which help you every day to improve your quality of work. And then the cloud-based registry for the outcome analysis and the telemedicine concept for giving the second opinion. Sorry. So the medical record is very important because you have to see a complete overview over the patient. That means the electronic medical record have to give you all the important information, like images of the devices, drawings or whatever, or measurements or curves or graphs about the visual acuity or intraocular pressure, so that you have an overall view over the examinations. So your EMR has to follow the international standards, like reading curves, give you a very good overview over the graphical user interface, and has to be mixed between abbreviations and mouse clicks, and also to give in free text. So that means in some parts of your practice, you need more text, and in some part of the practice you need more button commands or whatever. So it's a different use between the staff and the doctors. So in most of the clinics, or the system has to follow international standards. That means in most of the cases the system is not running alone, it's running in an embedded landscape of different software modalities. That means if you decide for an EMR, it has to follow the international standards like HL7, that means health level language 7, to communicate with other systems, for transmitting or transferring data, image data, the system has to follow the DICOM standard, and it has to be possible that your vendor is all ways participating to the IHE, Healthcare Enterprise symposiums, maybe in US every 2 weeks before the AAO starts. All the vendors are come together to test and to prove how they can communicate together. Oops. Sorry, we have implemented the system here in Saudi Arabia with the Maghrabi group. So that means we started in 2010 to install the system around the main hospital in Jeddah and two other branches. And then we can continue with the two subsidiaries in Riyadh, with a new Riyadh hospital, which is one of the first hospitals in the world who works directly with an EMR system and got the JCI accreditation. And end of February and March this year, we continue the installation in the eastern part of KSA, that means Dammam al-Quba and Al-Hasa. And I'm on my way now to inventory all these other branches in UAE to continue hopefully next year or this year with installing the system in Doha, in Abu Dhabi, in Dubai, in Qatar and Oman as well. So that means here you see the chronological history of the installation and implementation of the system. Right now we have more than 380 workstations in place with the interface of more than 175 instruments. That's a huge number, so that means every day, I don't know the number, how many patients you treat every day, but we can say that is a lot. The key for success was to build up the workflow management or the workflow of the existing hospital in Jeddah. So that means if the patient comes to the reception, the patient will establish in the main system from DMS, it's an hospital information system. Then the information goes to the medical record. That means if the patient is available, the system, or not available, the patient go directly to the nurse station. If there is already an existing paper file, the information goes to the medical record archive, and this file will be scanned in immediately so that all informations are available in the EMR system. After that, normally they go to the pre-assessment, so autorefractor lens meter, intraocular pressure. So the devices are connected to our system. Then the nursing assessment has to be done, and after that the patient goes to the clinical exam to the physician. So if the doctor decides, they have to make an additional investigation, an order goes back to the nurse station, and they will do the complete investigation like OCT, Pentacam, OPD scan, visual field, IOL master or whatever. And these results are transferring directly in the electronic medical record so that the doctor can do the test interpretation and can send the patient to the OR admission. That is a very important workflow. We build it up in every Maghrabi branches right now. So, to reach this target, we have to make a lot of things in advance. So that means if you are thinking about implementation of EMR, you have to think backwards, minimum 9 to 12 months in advance for planning the complete project. So that means it's divided in five different time steps. So first of all, you have to decide and you have to sign the contract. Then you have to analyze the complete existing processes and have to concept how you want to change your existing paper processes to electronic processes. And then you have to do the implementation and roll out together with your vendor. And after, so 60, 70 days, you will reach the meaningful use stage. That means 80% of the data you filled in every day are structured. So this is a statistics of one of the clinics in KSA. That means that the ratio between different entry types, our preference is that you have to give in the data or fill in the data in a structured way, because otherwise you can't analyze the data very, very good. So that means here you see the different doctors and how they enter the data, more structured, more in free text or whatever. That's for the vision type, and that's an important part for the diagnosis. So there you can see some doctors are working more proper, more in a structured way, and some doctors are using more the free text. And that gives the complete group the chance to increase or to improve the database so that in the near future more doctors only will enter abbreviations. Here you see a very important statistic. It's going over more than 8 months, and there you see the improvement of the complete completion rate of important data in the electronic file. It's divided in chief complaint, vision, eyelids, conjunctiva, and they started in January 2014, and you see how they increase or increase their completion rate to a structured way. So we have in different countries, we have different efficiency with using the electronic medical record. That means in Germany, we started with medical records in 1996. So a lot of doctors are working very efficiently. They examine more than 80 to 100 patients per day with an EMR. Similar, the same in the US. China is back behind USA and Germany. And so that we'll see, you can improve your efficiency with using the EMR. So when you want to implement an EMR system, so you have to divide it in three different responsibility parts. That means, first of all, the clinical implementation there are the doctors responsible to give all their input into the system, how they document the different subspecialties and how they use the instruments and so on. Then the non-clinical implementation, which will cover more the workflow and the administrative part, and then the IT implementation, which is more on a technical level to see how we can interface the PCs, the different locations and so on. And these have to be to watch by a proper project management, that you will implement this complete solution in time. So when we implement a system, we build a complete team cooperation between the vendor and the eye clinic. So there are defined responsibilities on both sides so that we can work together in a process, in a work group, to define all the very important parts of the implementation, like non-clinical, clinical, and IT implementation. So what are the changes and benefits for ophthalmologists worldwide? So all clinical information together you have on one screen. You have a better protection based on professional documentation, and you can prevent medical errors in clinical and surgical ophthalmology, and you can improve the administrative efficiency with using the system. For the patient has a feeling that they will get a higher quality. The patient's safety is very important. We have watchdog systems behind the databases. In the next minute, Robert will introduce you more in this clinical decision support system. Then we have a very good patient education dedicated to the individual diseases. You can improve your patient services based on structured workflows so that the patient has the feeling everything is running proper. Okay, now I give the floor to Robert. He will introduce you the ECPEC system. Thank you for your attendance.
So welcome as well from my side. Thanks for coming to this talk. I'll introduce you now to ECPEC system. ECPEC is a solution that we would apply in many cases in the environment of general hospitals with an eye care department. What you quite often have is the situation that you have a general hospital information system, that you have probably a PAC system, but the ophthalmology departments are more or less left alone because the general HIS providers do not support that much ophthalmology solutions. They cannot deal with the variety of diagnostic devices that we often find and do not really have the knowledge and understanding of the special needs of eye care. We have so many numeric data and special needs, and in general, ophthalmology is very small compared to inner medicine, radiology, and so on. So what then happens is that you're missing, So which button is the for the laser? Oh yeah, okay. I have it. So what you see quite often is that we don't have that solution, we don't have these interfaces, and the structured data set we don't have as well. What we introduce is then a so-called ECPAC system. That system offers the interfaces to a variety of more than 450 devices, from autorefractors to the non-contact tonometers to imaging systems. And it allows drawing on the images, comparing the images, reporting, and the communication of all that data. We connect with a huge amount of brands all around the world. In principle, we don't have a limitation. Sometimes it's only a limitation if we have a too old device that we find in a clinic that would not have an interface at all. But we have a very good and established cooperation with all these vendors. The architecture in such a clinic normally looks like that we have a existing hospital information system, probably a PACS system as well, and then an intermediate system will be implemented, the ECPACS gateway that takes care of devices that probably have a DICOM interface. If we don't have DICOM interfaces, we would use an additional service that takes care of all the others, and then refractive information as well, and combines all that and puts it into a ophthalmology subsolution that then can be integrated into the hospital information system. It may be used as a standalone situation, but quite often we find that highly integrated, and it helps providing solutions in hospitals where the IT department or the hospital in general does not provide a full service, but it would manage all your data, imaging, and refractive data. And then you can as well document your findings, diagnosis, interpretation, and transfer these information back into the hospital information system, like procedure codes, diagnosis codes, whatever is necessary. We offer tools, or the system should offer tools, for statistics, queries, and outcome analysis. In our case, we have the experience of 30 years in this market and have a good understanding of the needs of our partners and clients in this market. And it's easy to learn, easy to use, as we follow certain international standards as well for graphical user interface usability. And it can be upgraded. So in case somebody really wants to go from a first solution, wants to go to a full electronic EMR for ophthalmology, that can be upgraded as well at any time. Next topic would be, that was mentioned already by Guido, the clinical decision and support system. What does that mean? What is that for? A clinical decision and support system would combine observations with the health knowledge that we have in the clinics or that we have in the medical community to provide better choices by the clinicians to improve the healthcare. So we would try to reduce misdiagnosis. We would try to reduce medication errors and improve quality of care for our patients. The entire process certainly starts with an electronic medical record. So to provide such a clinical decision support system basis as an EMR that would be using structured information. Structured information is necessary because only if I have coded and structured data, I can analyze that quickly to make decisions based on electronic tools. The next topic then is that with the terminology that we use, we do all the documentation, the data entry into the system with the workflow management. And then finally, in the data processing, we have the patient chart, we have the total patient information. And then with the knowledge base that is implemented into the system, that inference engine of the clinical decision support system gives me proposals. What should I do? What should I recommend to the patient? And then is giving me the output towards the patient. That is a screenshot of an overview. If I have a patient, like in this case, we have a showcase patient, which is a glaucoma patient, has certain glaucoma indications, and then it might pop, the system automatically pops up with a list of activities, list of topics that were selected by the clinical decision and support system. And that is based on the, for each individual case, on different parameters that I can choose. It could be demographics, it could be refractive data that I have, it could be findings, diagnosis, any kind of observations, therapies that I would include in my filter criteria or exclude, combine all that to have a proper information system. Typical question is, what do we do if we, for example, have a cardiac patient that we shall give certain ophthalmology-based medications and there would be an interference that could be entered in such a system? And especially in bigger institutes where you have residents, where you have students, where you have young people that would be educated, they would have a proper support by having such kind of automated systems. Good. So these are the components that we need, starting with the electronic medical record, as mentioned initially. We need the terminology base. The knowledge base is coming out of the team or out of the community of ophthalmology. And then within the workflow and with a chart monitor, we would then have the data that would be fit into the inference engine, and that provides then our solutions. The next topic that we wanted to address to you is registry and clinical research. Registries are used to combine all clinical data, filter that in out of the medical record, put that into a data management tool. Most of the cases it's cloud-based, and these data systems are then stored central to perform outcome analysis. Outcome data are then reviewed for clinical records, clinical research, or even administrative purposes. The clinical reports are evaluated for the evidence-based medicine, and then guidelines can be developed out of these results and being published back into the community. These guidelines are formatted into preferred clinical pathways, and these clinical pathways again then can go back into clinical decision support systems. So you see that there is a loop that with the data that we record, we can do the analysis, we can put that into clinical research systems, and then out of that data we can then have again new rules, new regulations, new ideas that go back into the clinical decision support systems. An architecture for something like that might look pretty complicated. I don't want to bore you with the details of that. The sample that I'm talking about right now is the Euriquo database. I'll show you one more slide. That is a cloud-based disease registry for cataract and refractive surgery. It's initiated by the ESCRS. It was funded originally by the European Community, something established like in 2008, 2009. And today, the system covers 1.1 million or more than 1.1 million sets of cataract surgery data. And more than 1,200 surgeons out of 18 countries are entering that database. Euriquo is a still live system. The ESCRS has just 1.5 years made the decision, first time in the living of this Euriquo project, to use their system for a clinical study as well. So we have extended the database for the Euriquo, and right now there is a study ongoing that compares femtocataract surgery versus classic cataract surgery. And if I recall correctly, the first results we should probably see either at the ESCRS winter meeting right now or latest then in summer Barcelona at the summer meeting of the ESCRS. That system can be expanded. The ESCRS right now is interested to expand it on a worldwide scale to bring more users, more application into the system. The Euriquo project is within the ophthalmology by far the largest registry that is existing worldwide in terms of users that are entering data and entered patient data. Another topic that is connected to health IT is telemedicine applications. Telemedicine applications are then used if you have remote locations where you want to enter data and you want to improve the utilization of the limited capacity of medical experts in the different locations. The example that I'm going to talk about, and I'm jump over some of these slides here, is a diabetic retinopathy screening application that is established first time around about 15 years ago in the US. What we do there is we have a screening device, now a very modern one, the Retival device here on the left-hand side, very easy to use screening tool for diagnosing diabetic retinopathy or macular edema that can be done in remote places. That data is then entered into a secured and protected database, goes into central reading centers. That is then, like on this slide, that you have all these reading centers in the different applications, whether it's on community hospitals, primary care, multi-special hospitals, or especially in ophthalmology clinics. That then goes all into those teleretinal centers. There you have specialists that are reading these that information. You may, on a second level, then add special services like seven-field stereo imaging. Even that is then documented and reviewed by expert. That the expert information goes back into the electronic system, and then you have on the remote places the information available. That system here is in place, as I said, around about 15 years, is used in the US with the Veterans Administration system. So it's even in cooperation with the US FDA and is used by governmental organizations to screen the VA patients, those patients that are living in these VA centers on remote places. So it's a mobile service. That information is then centralized and the information goes back, and then you have a very comfortable situation for the patient. Don't have to bring him to the clinics, to the special clinics. You can do that on the remote place where he is living, and in case he needs a special care, you can then send him to the ophthalmologist. A short summary then at the end of our presentation about some international health aspects. My colleague Guido has mentioned already that we have special situation like in Germany, Austria and Switzerland, where out about 85% of the outpatient clinics are working paperless already today. That was initiated by the fact, for example, in Germany that since mid-90s, doctors are forced to do their electronic their billing electronically, so no paper billing is allowed anymore, and most of them have converted already to full electronic medical records, where you still see the one or other user in the outpatient clinics that still is on paper. A different scenario we have in university clinics, in the bigger hospitals, where we have many of those hospitals still on paper. That is now a wave that is coming along around about since 1-2 years in Central Europe, where the patients are, where the clients are asking more and more for ophthalmology solutions for paperless records in those bigger institutes. Certainly, all of them want to follow those standards mentioned already, HL7 for communication of the different systems for more administrative data, DICOM for imaging, or then the IHE conformance that proves that you can talk and communicate with your other systems. In the US, the situation is, in principle, completely different. If you go back around about 5 years ago, the US has been completely behind. The buzzword there is the meaningful use, is the stimulus project that goes back even to the Bush administration, was then under Obama's administration, then rolled out. The US government has enacted the law to fund health IT with a total of $24 billion, a market situation that we unfortunately, from a manufacturer's point of view, don't have in other markets so far. Would be nice, but they have invested that, and right now in the US, electronic medical records is rolled out all over the places, not only in ophthalmology, in all specialties, under a certain umbrella of conditions that you have to fulfill. It has to be certified EMR systems, clinical decision support system are mandatory as well, like patient portals, electronic patient portals, where I as a patient can watch information that is entered by my physician within 72 hours. He has to provide that system electronically. Patient education, all that is part of the needs and requirements, strict requirements of the US health IT plans right now. And in the US as well, certainly, we have to follow certain standards like the HL7, the DICOM, IHE, and there even SNOMED compatibility is required. And with that short overview, we are closing that session about health IT. Now, I thank you very much for listening to us and wish you a continuous successful Congress here. Thank you.